Can you remember being born, Bob? You're being born. Can you remember it? You can't remember anything about being born. We're taking you back into your mother's womb. Can you remember anything in your mother's womb? Bob, remember anything? Speak if you can. I'm going to take you back beyond the barrier of birth. If you can see anything, let me know. As we count the centuries back, you will, if there's some consciousness, you will know it. If there isn't, you will say it's dark. You understand? Open their hands and who can. If you can't, don't be alarmed. If they're frozen, don't be alarmed. Hi. Who's frozen? Okay. Okay. Open. Oh, okay. You're right. Okay. Now, we have shown one thing what can be done with a psychosomatic suggestion. Bob, Maria's going to talk to you, and it's all right to answer her questions.
Bob, there are many people who probably won't believe that this is really happening to you. They might think that you are a setup. What can you say, or what goes through your mind to prove that you are actually in a trance?
Well, I know what's going on all the time. I hear everybody talking. And I know what is when I went through the four-year-old spanking stage. And I think about it, but I cannot seem to stop myself from doing it.
Do you really believe this?
I'm not sure I do, no.
Yes, I believe it. I just think that it's a suggestion of your subconscious, and that he has had enough power to suggest it, and so he's relived these experiences.
You agree?
I agree.
Now, wake up, Bob. How do you feel? When you put your hold it like this.
Okay. I'm going to lay these out in a very simple pattern. The first card will be a card that covers you. So right over you, the High Priestess, is the card of the Magician, or Hermes. And beneath you is the Queen of Pentacles. And above you is the Page of Cups. Now, in a tradition of divination, the Magician would explain to you what powers or energies are available to you. So really, as a practical means of psychotherapy, is the way that the gypsy fortune teller, once a year, he'd come into town and straighten out everybody's head for them, you see. That's why they dug him. They're very complex patterns. They're very simple patterns. This is a simple one. He'd put one card on the past, and that card, like, would be a Four of Pentacles. It would be anchored down in materiality, the pentacles being the suit that's concerned with Earth. So your fortune, like, would depend upon this very firm but very solid and low-level earthly structure, and then your fortune would be read in terms of this possibilities that are open for you out of the chance of all these cards. Why should just those cards come up, you see? Nobody could tell you what they meant. It'd be like, these are the powers that are available to you, and if you want to use them, you use them. If there are dangers, then you're aware of them, so you avoid them.
So in a sense, you're saying that the individual has a ability to control their destiny rather than just acting as if this is a mirror of the future?
That's certainly the theory of the tradition of the tarot, yeah, is that it's wide open, that it's simply a message from chance, and you read it and you do with it with whatever you want. You can go to the future, which would be to the other side of this, with a bridge card. The bridge card that came up for you is the Day of Judgment. But
what does that mean?
This is the apocalypse. It's all over. But it's ready to start again because it's all cyclical and it has to do with death and rebirth. In terms of your life, I don't know what this would mean, but this would be some event that would cross your path and it would be a bridge to the future. There are many different readings traditionally throughout Western art history for each one of these cards. This card also becomes a card for the Enlightenment. So it may be that you're on your path to being enlightened.
Let's hope so.
That enlightenment would lead to this future. And that's a card, the Eight of Wands, or the Eight of Clubs, would be the bridge suit. And that just means change. It means total change. Everything's swirling around you. And so after enlightenment, maybe the world looks like that for a while.
This is called a test for clairvoyance, actually, because you're not getting the information from anything but your intuition about which card belongs where. And as soon as you've done that, we'll turn them over and see exactly how well you've
done. Am I supposed to be thinking?
No, actually, you're not supposed to be thinking, because we think ESP is an unconscious process. Well, you got the first one, right? You got two, okay? Now we'll take here and see how you've done there. And you only got one there, but you're still doing pretty well.
What's the difference between this, say, and women's intuition?
I don't know. Women's intuition may be a form of ESP, and on the other hand, it may not. So far, you've gotten five correct. If you got any, there, you're slightly above chance. There are people who have been known to do this and get all 25 correct. And we think when that happens, and they can do it with some degree of regularity, that this is a very good demonstration of ESP. They've developed a new type of photography called high-frequency electrical field photography, very complicated word. But what it does do, when it takes a photograph of, for example, here's a Kopeck coin, you get what they call a bioplasma body emerging around it, which, in old-fashioned terms, we called an aura surrounding a body or a person, which they also get when they photograph a leaf. And I'm told that when the pictures are taken in color, they're very beautiful color emissions coming out and changing according to the state of the health of the organism. They can do it with people, too.
Is this just a photographic experience?
It's a photographic technique.
Just a technique?
It's just a technique, the way X-rays are a photographic technique which will show the inside of the body. This shows an actual apparent aura of some kind, a bioplasma body that emanates. This is fingertips. And in a state of health, we apparently are emitting this from our fingertips. Now, they did a very fascinating thing with a man who's supposed to be able to heal with his hands. They took a very magnified picture of, actually it goes this way, of his thumb under an electron microscope. And this is his thumb in a state of rest, and you see these projections of what look like fire, almost like the sun's corona, coming off from his thumb tip when he's not working as a healer. Then when he does start to work as a healer, we get this fantastic discharge of this bioplasma body. And their suggestion, their belief is that perhaps when a person claims to be healing with his hands, the laying on of hands that was talked about in the Bible, that maybe there is some sort of influence that can be photographed with this process. here are four lights, red, yellow, green, and blue. And depending on which button you press, if you think the blue one's going to light up, you press that button, and it was wrong. Try it again for the green. I was wrong. Go ahead. Nope. Keep on going. Now you got a hit there. Now you got another hit. Another hit. Keep on going. You're doing very well. Four hits in a row. That's very unusual.
When young irrationalists talk about the superiority of living under the rule of the subconscious over the conscious, I'm reminded of a drunken driver, because that's the perfect example of a life run without conscious control. And the smash which occurs to him physically occurs to these young people psychologically, and sometimes physically also. Mysticism, the supernatural, the occult are born out of fear. They are born out of psychological terror. Now, people have a great deal to be terrified of in the world today, it is true. But if ever they needed their rational faculties, it's now. Unfortunately, too often when people are frightened, their rational faculties are the first things they drop. And they reach for astrology, religion, some other kind of occultism, Satanism perhaps, imagining that they will thereby give themselves some kind of security, some kind of reassurance that the world isn't as they're perceiving it to be, or that they are on the side of some kind of higher powers that will give them some kind of protection.
What can be done to turn the current trends toward a more rational direction?
To begin with, I don't think it's going to last. I think we have made too much intellectual progress. I think it's a fad. I think it's so flagrantly a bankrupt dead end that I think people will get bored and tired of it in the not-too-distant future, and it will collapse again into oblivion, because it is so irrelevant to life and to our needs today. I think that what is needed is everyone who is competent to do so, philosophers, psychologists, ethicists, writers, talking about reason and about the urgent need of a return to reason and the application of reason to deal with man's problems on Earth.
Like it sounds so weepy.